Hello everyone, this is Erik, the Asian movie enthusiast, and this is my review of Ip Man 4, The Finale, a Hong Kong action flick directed by Wilson Yip that stars Donnie, of course, and Scott Adkins. Now, it was released originally in December of 2019, but just recently received a release on streaming and physical media in the United States. After his rebellious son fights back against a bully and is expelled from school, Ip Man decides to travel to California to look for a school for his son. His student, Bruce Lee, has upset the local martial arts community in San Francisco by opening a martial arts school and teaching the Americans martial arts, and then writing an English language book on martial arts. And the other masters do not like that idea much at all, which causes some tension. So, right off the bat, near the beginning of the film, you know, Ip Man's son, kind of a whiny, spoiled brat in this movie. I did not like his character at all. Thankfully, he's not in the film much. On the contrary, in San Francisco, we are introduced to another teenage character. And she's the daughter of one of the martial arts masters, and she's far more likable. She's rebellious, you know, like teenagers usually are, but also kind of begrudgingly does what her dad kind of tells her to do sometimes, even though she doesn't want to do it. The actress, Vondra Margraff, plays that angle very nicely and does not come off as a spoiled brat while doing it. So she did a good job in this. She's pretty tough-minded, too, at times. You know, she can kind of defend herself a little bit, too, in terms of fighting. And she gets a good amount of screen time, and I liked her in this film. I really liked her character. Danny Chan is quite good as Bruce Lee. He's actually played Bruce Lee multiple times in the past in other movies. I think even way back in Shaolin Soccer, I think he played Bruce Lee, or a Bruce Lee-type character in that one. Now, he's not as fast as Bruce, right? We all know this. But in this film, I was kind of surprised at his athleticism and his speed. You know, he has the mannerisms down pretty good at this point in his career. He's just a supporting actor in this, but he does get more screen time than he did in Ip Man 3. And I liked him in this. Scott Adkins plays the villain, and he's entertaining to watch. He is. He plays it up nicely. You know, he kind of hams it up a little bit, but he commands the screen when he's present. You know, he gets a moderate amount of screen time, just enough to be satisfying, and he makes the most of it. There's no reason for this guy not to be a big action star. There really isn't. I hear people make all kinds of excuses why Scott Adkins shouldn't be cast in a big movie. You know, like, oh, he's not the best actor or something. Compared to, like, who? Like, if Vin Diesel gets lead roles in big-time action movies, I'm sorry. Scott Adkins deserves to be there as well. You know, I wasn't entirely convinced like 10 years ago when I kept hearing his name on internet forums. I'm like, who's this Scott Adkins guy? But after seeing like, you know, I don't know, a few dozen of his movies or something at this point, I'm convinced this guy needs to be in some big time flicks. And not in tiny supporting roles where he's not utilized. So, yeah, just my opinion on him. Now, one thing you'll notice in Ip Man 4 is that it shifts back to that Ip Man 2 formula of portraying most of the Caucasian characters as being like evil, mustache-twirling villains. But in this case, it's the Americans instead of the British. Now, apparently this was like a problem for some people who watched the film. Listen, when I was a kid, I was watching Sylvester Stallone and Chuck Norris fight all kinds of evil foreigners in our American films. I mean, the 80s were just loaded with American propaganda films, many of which were pretty entertaining action flicks. They really were. So when another country does it, and they do it in an entertaining action film, and they present it as like a propaganda piece, I actually find it to be a pretty interesting experience because it kind of reflects what the filmmakers from that particular country think that their primary audience wants to see. So I kind of find it amusing and kind of interesting because you get a feel for you know, different industries around the world, you know, who they really don't like or who they like to portray as evil. And it's, I don't know, I just find it to be an interesting cinematic kind of, experiment of sorts, right? So that didn't bother me, and I actually found it to be quite amusing that most of the Caucasian characters, if not almost all of them, are like, you know, just mustache twirling evil people. So that was pretty pretty fun, actually. Now, plot-wise, there is one conflict that just they just leave hanging at the end of the film. I don't think I could talk about it exactly because it might be considered a spoiler. But if you pay attention near the end, it just kind of disappears after the final fight, as if like the final fight would have rectified it, when in fact it really probably wouldn't have. So that's just something I noticed. I think they just left that one hanging out there a little bit, and it kind of distracted me a bit at the very end of the film. But what about the fights? You know, as you might expect, they're very good. If you're at all familiar with this franchise, you know exactly what to expect. A bunch of high-quality precision strike exchanges that are properly directed and edited. There's nothing else to say. So I'll give you a rundown here real quick on some of these fights you can expect. You know, we get a little, you know, like the other films in this franchise, it likes to pepper in some very short, like 30-second to 1-minute fights every once in a while. So you get a handful of those. The first, like, legit fight scene occurs at about the 30-minute mark, involving Bruce Lee's character. And like I said previously, Danny Chan can move well, and the fight I thought was very entertaining. I think he nailed that scene. There's, again, a short fight involving a schoolgirl rivalry. So what I learned from this film is that you never want to get on the bad side of an angry teenage girl, because this fight is pretty mean-spirited, and it's an excessive act of revenge that's motivated because this evil white girl came in second place in a cheerleading practice competition, and she gets pissed. So, but it's a decent, scrappy little fight. It's pretty neat. I liked it. The next big-time fight is a one-on-one match between Ip Man and one of the Masters. Solid fight. That one emphasizes, like, technique a lot. Near the one-hour mark, we get a multi-staged fight sequence at a festival at night. Really cool environment with a lot of lanterns and stuff like that. The set designs in this movie are actually pretty cool. And that fight is impressive because it involves, you know, multiple characters. And it's pretty cool how it plays out. And there's a dramatic context to that because the staff sergeant, who's of Chinese heritage, I believe, it's like holding his camera down. Like he's like filming the festival, all excited, and then he holds the camera down when the bad guys show up because he's not entirely confident that Chinese martial arts will win that fight. And I like how they kind of played that out a little bit dramatically. That was pretty cool. And then after that, Scott Adkins just kind of takes over the film. So he gets multiple fights. You know, obviously he gets two big ones, one against one martial arts master, and then you got Donnie, of course, in the finale. And there's enough action in this film to satisfy. It's a high enough quality to satisfy. I'm satisfied. So, if you're a fan of the franchise, I say check it out. Like I said, you know, I read a few reviews online. The people who complained about it seemed to not like the cartoonish villains, but I don't care. if you're a fan of Ip Man 2, definitely watch this, because you basically get the same evil cartoonish villains just from a different country. And, you know, I'm in the minority. I know I'm in the minority, but I like Ip Man 3 the most out of all of them. It's just, I think Jin Zhang's character and his arc and the way his character was, because he wasn't like a good guy or a bad guy. He was like a wild card. And I found his infusion into that story was really kind of edged out the other three films in this main franchise in terms of just being interesting character dynamics. That's just my opinion, but I really like Ip Man 3, but they're all really good. So do a marathon if you haven't seen them. This is currently available on Amazon streaming and physical media now in the United States. And as always, I'll see you next time.